up your bulletins this morning, as our greeters and ushers handed you one as you walked through the doors, you'll read in the title, you'll read in the message box the title, and the title of our conversation is, does somebody want to give me a shout out? Yeah, it's got to be the banquet table. We have Thanksgiving coming up, so we have to talk about the banquet table. You know, usually on the holidays, it's always good to do your research and remember your history and why we celebrate Thanksgiving. So, you know, even as I reflected back on some of the first Thanksgivings that we celebrated here as a nation, Thanksgiving Day, you know, the first celebration of Thanksgiving in America is dated back, believe it or not, it's dated far back to 1621. 1621, that's almost 400 years ago. That's really when the first demonstration or acknowledgement of the holiday was. And most of you know it was at Plymouth, and it was in regard to the settlers giving thanks to God for the harvest that came that kept them all alive, you know? Yes, yeah. And that's why that's part of our Thanksgiving feast. We celebrate usually the Thanksgiving feast. It's supposed to be the items that God provided for us in the land during the harvest. And we celebrate the fruits of the harvest that God has blessed us with. So that's part of our holiday. But, you know, it was in 1789, when President George Washington officially proclaimed the first nationwide Thanksgiving celebration. And with George Washington, he not only acknowledged God for the harvest, but he acknowledged God for all of the favors and all of the blessings that he poured out, that God poured out upon America. Amen?
Amen.
So in this, that was kind of weak, but anyway, this should have been a strong amen. Can I get another amen?
Amen.
Yeah. God bless America. God bless America. And to this day, we will pause and we will say, Lord, thank you for being so good to us. Thank you for the abundant mercies and favors that you have poured out upon our land. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for the freedoms that we all share.
Amen.
And we say, God bless America.
Yes.
God bless America. So, you know, as some of you are preparing for your Thanksgiving meal on Thursday, is anybody preparing for a Thanksgiving meal? I'm just curious, in this house, who here is in charge of cooking the bird? Anybody? Can anybody raise their hands? Okay, the heat is all on you guys. Huh? It's all up to you. It's all up to you. Who's in charge of the rolls? By raise of hands, the rolls. Can you get them to the table on time, please? I've been celebrating Thanksgiving forever. They are never on time. Usually I get them at the end of the meal and they're burnt. Somebody sits up in the middle of the meal, oh, the buns. Every year. That's just a little bitter complaint of mine, but anyway. Sister Andrea, we love you. We're glad you're here. God bless you in the name of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And we celebrate with you the new things that God's doing in your life. You know, for Thanksgiving dinner, I might need another mic. I'll keep this going in and out and drive me nuts. Thank you. Okay, praise the Lord. Give me one second. I'm going to take this old one off. Now, you see, when you think of a Thanksgiving meal, I don't know what you envision. Some of us envision different things, you know. One of the things I would like for you to envision today is, I would like for you to envision the banquet table. The banquet table. And I know everybody in this room has experienced a banquet table for Thanksgiving. If not, last Wednesday, right here in church, we had our Thanksgiving dinner. And what a beautiful banquet table we had. I know some of you have some large families, but we had almost 100 here on our Thanksgiving dinner. That was a beautiful banqueting table. Amen?
Amen.
Beautiful. And when you envision the banquet table, you know, I don't know, how many of you guys like set up like a real big table for Thanksgiving? Like usually you have six, but for that day you got like 20 or 15, or some of you one or two, whatever it might be. But you see, at some point during the holiday, we do get together with friends and family and we celebrate and acknowledge the goodness of God. So with that, I want you to turn with me to a feast that's mentioned in the Bible. I think it's a Thanksgiving feast. And it's found in the book of Isaiah, the 25th chapter, and I would like to read the first 8 verses. And this passage here, Isaiah 25, it's very special to me. I shared this passage with my mother so many years ago in regard to some of the things that we were experiencing. And this passage here is a passage that was given to give us encouragement and strength and hope. So with this passage here in Isaiah 25, why don't you read with me? Let's read the first 8 verses. It says, Lord, you are my God. I would exalt you and praise your name, for in perfect faithfulness you have done wonderful things. I'm going to pause from verse to verse. You have done wonderful things things planned long ago. Amen? You see, God has planned your life a long time ago. And this is one of the verses that gives me comfort, and I pray it gives you comfort. God has planned your life a long time ago. And you know what he's planned for you a long time ago? Wonderful things, I think it says. Wonderful things. And this is one of the things that we hold on to. It's one of the hopes that we have in Christ. God planned a long time ago, he planned your life, and he planned wonderful things for you. Let us go on, brother. You have made the city a heap of rubble, the fortified town a ruin, the foreigner's stronghold a city no more. And we'll pause here again. It will never be rebuilt. You see, sometimes when we experience these things in our lives, we need the word of the Lord. And the word of the Lord says, listen, I know that you might be experiencing a heap of rubble from time to time. Any of you experience the heap of rubble from time to time? But you see, the word of the Lord is this. He says, I planned for you a long time ago wonderful things. Thank you, Jesus. In the midst of some of these things. Let us go on. Therefore, this is beautiful. Therefore, strong people will honor you. Yeah, let the mighty honor our God. Cities of ruthless nations will revere you, O God. You have been a refuge for the poor, a refuge for the needy in their distress, a shelter for the storm, such for some of you, right? A shelter for the storm and a shade from the heat. For the breath of the ruthless is like a storm driving against a wall. And like the heat of the desert, you silence the uproar of foreigners as heat is reduced by the shadow of a cloud. So the song of the ruthless is stilled. Thank you, Lord. And then this beautiful passage here, verse 6, I think it is. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare. Here's your banquet, everybody. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for how many people?
All.
That's Pastor Phil's word right there, for all peoples. And then it goes on, it says, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats, and the finest of wines. On this mountain again, on this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from their faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. Amen.
Amen.
The word of the Lord, everybody. The word of the Lord. You see, in this passage here, it talks about a feast that God has prepared for how many peoples?
All
peoples. You know, let us call it today, let us call it our Thanksgiving feast. Let us call the banquet that God has prepared for us. And, you know, even as we go through it this week, as you leave the doors today and you go through the week and some of you are preparing for a Thanksgiving dinner or some time with family, there's three things I want you to remember, three things that are found at this feast that I think God wants to give us, and I pray that you remember them. I pray that even as you sit at your Thanksgiving dinner with your friends and your family, you remember three of the things that might be on the table that is before you that day, three of the things of the banquet that God has prepared for us. And the first thing I want to talk about just for a moment, the first thing is found in verse 7. Brother Keith, you got that for us again? The first thing in verse 7, and I'm going to read it again, it says, on this mountain he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. You know, in the King James Version, I want to read it, it says, and he will destroy in this mountain the face of the coverings cast over the people, and the veil that is spread over the nations. The first thing that God wants to do, you still with me, everybody? The first thing that God wants to do in our feast, our banqueting table, is he wants to remove the veil. He wants to remove the veil that covers what? What does the veil cover? According to Scripture, the veil always covers the glory of the Lord. And what God wants to do in this banqueting feast is forever and ever, he wants to remove the veil from off of our eyes, from off of our minds, whatever it is that keeps us from seeing the glory of God.
Yes.
And maybe the first thing that we can experience in our Thanksgiving feast as we sit down at the table is maybe we can look around the table and maybe God in his sovereignty will remove the veil that covers our eyes and let us see the glory of God that is all around the table this Thanksgiving day, everybody.
Amen.
How about that? Let us look by the mercies of God. Let us look into the faces of our friends, the faces of our families, the faces of our neighbors, and may God cause us to celebrate and remove this shroud that doesn't allow us to see the goodness of God in every man, woman, and child.
Amen.
I pray. I pray. And not only for this Thanksgiving Day feast, I pray that we're entering into a new season where God would allow us to see his glory that is truly all around us. And have you experienced that from time to time? You know, from time to time, does God lift the veil from our faces, from our eyes, and allows us to see the people in our lives are blessings, not curses, anybody in the house?
Yes. Amen.
Right? That our family members are filled with the glory of God.
Yes.
And we can go even past the banqueting table. We can go throughout the whole earth and see that the whole earth is filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah, so for this feast that we're entering into, I pray that the veil is removed. The veil is removed. And some of the things that I've written down here, you know, that veil is always symbolic in the Bible. It's symbolic of the old covenant. And God wants to remove. He wants to remove the old covenant. But you know, in modern day terms, I think what God is looking to do in your life and my life is he's trying to remove, and he's in the process of moving, the old way we think. You know, for the only way that you and I could see the glory of God in each other's faces is if we change the way we think.
Amen.
If we change what we believe. If we start to believe that the people around us actually have good in their lives and God in their lives and love in their hearts for us. You know, sometimes we don't believe the people next to us actually love us or care about us. Or we don't think, sometimes we don't think that we love or care about them. And I pray that let love overtake us and let us, man, my goodness, we call ourselves Christians. Let the primary emotion, if you will, rise up in our heart, the emotion of love. Let us see that we love those people around us. Heck, we're not angry with them. Anybody in the house?
Yes.
We're not upset with them. We actually do love them. You see, the thing that God is removing from our lives, that veil is symbolic of an old covenant, but I believe it's always talking to us about an old way of thinking. An old way of thinking, you know? And even in Scripture calls the Old Covenant, it's interesting to me, Scripture calls the Old Covenant a ministration or ministry of death. Did I get it right from you, Pastor Dad? Yeah. It's interesting. A ministry of death. So with that, you know, sometimes our old thinking, the old thinking processes that we have in our lives, you know what they produce in our life?
Death.
Mm-hmm. See, the biggest thing that God is doing in our lives, he's changing the way we think. He's causing us to look at each other with different eyes. He's allowing us to see love and God and glory in all of those around us. And, you know, and I'm always reminded of Peter. Peter can be, let his words be written upon our hearts, where it says his prayer for us that we would not be a sin-conscious people, but a God-conscious people. And you know that's an ongoing thing that God's doing in our lives, because we know we still see sin in our lives. Oh my goodness. We still see sin in somebody else's lives, and we still see sin in the world today. You know why? I'll tell you why. I'll ask and answer. Because we're still sin conscious. That's why. We're sin conscious. And we don't know. We don't know that God set us free from that. We think we're doing the work of God. I think I'm doing the work of God, not by seeing the sin in my life. No. By seeing the sin in your life. Yes. Can I get a thank you, Jesus? No. Yeah, I'm doing the work of the Lord, man, because I'm telling you what, man, I see things that other people don't see. Let me tell you what I see. And if I see sin in you, you know, it's like the same message you preached last week, huh, Pastor Phil? Retread. You know, if I see sin in the world, I'm a sin-conscious person. God wants to remove the veil. Well, you start seeing differently and thinking differently. How do you think God is going to save the world? By changing the world?
No.
He's going to change you. And after he changes you, you're going to realize the world's already saved. But in our stinking thinking, we still think God's going to save the world because we haven't been redeemed ourselves yet. See, the first thing God's going to do is change my thinking. Once he changes my thinking, I can see that he already saved the world. I can start to see, I can be God-conscious now instead of sin-conscious. And instead of me looking in the world that I live in, looking around the table at Thanksgiving and seeing sin, I'll see God. Because the end of Peter's prayer was that we would not be sin-conscious, but what? God-conscious. We need to know that this is the will of God, otherwise we'll never let this be in our lives. We need to know God has to set us free. He has to allow us. Don't you feel the same thing? I feel like God has to allow me to do this. Otherwise, someone will say, like, you know, blah, 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 blah. But God has to allow us to say, no, I see God in you. I see God around the table. I see God in the world. Amen?
Amen.
See, the first thing that God is going to do for in this feast that he calls us to, the banqueting table, his banner over us is what?
Love.
His banner over us is love. No, the first thing on the table is this. He wants to remove our veils, our old thinkings, our old vision, and he wants us to start to see. He's not looking to change the people at your table. Once I change, that God changes them, then I'll see the glory. No, you'll see the glory not when God changes them. You'll see the glory when God changes you.
Amen.
Anybody in the house?
Yes.
I'm going to have to say that again because I think I need it. I will see the glory not when God changes them. I will see the glory when God changes me.
Amen.
When my veil is removed, then I'll actually begin to see the glory of God that is all around me. Give me one more amen and we'll move on.
Amen.
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 Praise the Lord. The second thing, and this is very much in line with our theme, Pastor Phil, victory and what we've talked about. The second thing is found in verse 8. Maybe let's read verse 8 again. And verse 8 says this. It says, I'll only read a portion of it. It says, he will swallow up death forever. Or in another version, it says, he will swallow up death, believe it or not, in victory. What's that big word behind me?
Mm-hmm.
Victory. He will swallow up death in victory. And it goes on, but at the bottom of it, it says this. It says, the Lord has spoken it. The Lord has spoken it. He will swallow up death in victory. Okay. This is what comforts me in this verse here. It doesn't say that I will swallow up death with victory. And it doesn't say you must swallow up death with victory. What does it say? It says he will. See, he's going to do the work in your life. You can't do it. Anybody with me on that one?
Yes.
I can't do it. And sometimes I say, if I can't do it, I know you can't do it. Sometimes I say, if Phil can't do it, I know I can't do it. See, I can't do these things. I cannot work the works of God. God has to work the works of God in my life. Amen?
Amen.
You see, all this life that we live, it's not because we're determined. It's not because we're strong. It's not because we're godly or holy in and of ourselves. It's because he chose us. He chose to save me. He chose to love me. Anybody else in the house? He will cause death to be swallowed up in your life, not based upon anything that you have the ability to do, because you don't have the ability. The only ability that I have in my life is to produce death. That's the only ability I have. You want some? No, I know you don't. The only ability I have. Marilyn. But you see, this table, God did the cooking. You want to know who cooked the turkey at this dinner? God.
Amen.
You want to know who cooked the biscuits at this dinner? God. They're right on time, man. He cooked it all. He's serving it all. He invited you all. Uh-huh. He does all the work. It's his banquet.
Yes.
And we are guests at his table.
Amen.
He will do the work. He's the one that's going to cause death to be swallowed up in my life. He's the one that's going to cause me to change my thinking. It's not like I got to constantly tear down. It's God working in my life, doing the tearing down. He will. And all of this passage, you know, this passage that we read here, and then we read it again in Corinthians, where it says, the dead in Christ shall rise first, right? And those who are alive and remain shall be caught up together and meet him in the air. It's not talking about a physical death. It's talking about the old covenant. The veil that's spoken of here, it's not talking about a physical death. It's talking about the old covenant, which we said earlier, Pastor Dad, was the ministry of death. That's the death that God is pulling from the earth. It's the old covenant. It's the old way of thinking. That's the death that's being swallowed up, not a physical death. So I tell you what, I have part in the resurrection. Every time I change, or God changes the way I think, there's a part of me that dies, and there's a part of me that is resurrected. Amen?
Amen.
See, God's going to do that all by himself, man. He causes death and resurrection to occur in your life all day, every day, man. It's not someday. I mean, it's a someday aspect to it. But it's also today. It's also yesterday. It's also tomorrow. What is this death that God is conquering? We all shed our tears at these funerals and say one day God will swallow up death. That's not the death he's speaking of, man. That's really not the death he's speaking of. The death that he's speaking of, I tell you what, man, because those people are still alive, man. My mom ain't dead. My uncle ain't dead. Your loved ones ain't dead. They're still alive. That's not the death he's conquering. That's already done. They live forever. Although you don't see your loved ones, they're still alive. They ain't dead. Can I get a witness from somebody? That's not the death he's destroying. That's already done. Signed, sealed, delivered, man. I don't know how long I'll be in this body, but it doesn't mean I'm dying per se. The death that God is delivering you from and delivering me from is my old way of thinking, man. It's me thinking you're a bum that's causing death, Phil. I think you're a bum sometimes, and it produces all kinds of anxiety at our dinner table. He won't pass the muffins. I won't pass the turkey. I don't even want to be there, for crying out loud. But it's family, you gotta go. I knew we were gonna get off course. What kind of death do you think that God is saving you from? Come on. Come on now. The death that he's saving you from is the way you think, man. Come on. The thing that you think is okay and safe, it ain't okay the way I think. The way I think produces death. It's the ministry of death. When I see sin and evil, when I do not see the glory of God that is all around me, I am partaking in the ministry of death, because all I see is the faults and the sins and the divisions and the anxieties and the he said, she said garbage. Amen?
Amen.
See, God is going to deliver you from death. What death is he talking about? He's talking about the old covenant. The veil is talking about the old covenant, the ministry of death, the law, or maybe something you can relate to easier, your old way of thinking. He's going to change the way you think. And he's going to deliver you. By changing the way you think, he's going to deliver you from death to life. That's what 1 Corinthians is talking about. The dead in Christ shall rise first. And then they which are alive and remain shall be caught up together and meet him in the air. That's what 1 Corinthians is. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. He, and who does the work, by the way? He will. He will. You know how God changes the way you think? You know how he does it? Does anybody know? You know, you're afraid to say. I'll tell you how God changes the way you think. I'll tell you how he changes how I think. You know what he uses? Life. He uses life. The ups and downs, the good times, the bad times. He uses life and it changes who we are. Can I get a witness from somebody?
Amen.
You know who he uses? Come on, I'll tell you what now. You know who he uses to bring you from death to life? You know who he uses? Aunt Betty and Uncle Jim around that table. Your cousin Lewis and your other crazy cousin Lewis. Do you know who God uses in your life to change you? The ones closest to you. The ones who you think are the devil incarnate put upon this earth either for you to save or for them to destroy you. It is my mission in life to get this person out of my family and out of my life.
Amen.
Now, I didn't expect that much laughter today. I really did not expect that much laughter. I didn't even think you were going to know what I was talking about. Yeah, that's right. The ones that you say, how did this one get in the family, man? They don't fit. Who let this one in? I refuse to acknowledge them as family. Yeah, that's the one that God put there to change you from death to life. That's the agent of God. That's God's agent sent there right for you. So sit close to them and share a meal with them. Yeah, what does God do to change you from death to life? Uh-huh. What does he do, man? He uses life.
Yeah.
So when you sit at your Thanksgiving dinner table, realize all those around the table, man, they're all agents of God. The ones you love and the ones you don't love so much. I know, geez, oh, I love them all. Yeah, I know. I know. Yes, yes, yes. He swallows up death in victory. He swallows up death. And this is our liberation. The liberation that he gives us, once again, the liberation that he gives us, it's the liberation from condemnation. It's the liberation from the condemnation that comes from the law that says you're constantly not measuring up. You're constantly doing the wrong thing. And everybody else around the table is constantly doing the wrong thing. Let him deliver us from this. But let me close with a couple of things that we can actually partake of on the table here. There's a couple of things on this table that God put before us that we were allowed to eat. And I think it's found in verse 6. Maybe we'll read verse 6 again. Two things. It says here, and this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people. And here is, it's a feast of fat things, a feast of wines on the lees, of fat things full of marrow, of wines on the lees well refined. Two things here. Two things. Our feasting will be, we're allowed to eat the fat, if you will. God says, I'm going to give you the fat to eat of. And you know, if we would convert that to our everyday living, I don't like to eat the fat. You know, I usually cut the fat off and push it to the side, right? You know, I just like the lean stuff, you know. But you see, and you know what's interesting also? The interesting thing also is this. Do you know in the old covenant that we're supposed to be delivered from or transformed from. In the old covenant, the Israelites and the priests, they weren't allowed to eat the fat. Do you know that? Amen. Amen. Oh, I got two amens from you, Pop. It's a good day, man. Woo-wee! I'm going to try for three. It's going to take us a while. You guys got a while? I'm trying for three. It's all right. My dad will say amen real quick.
Amen.
I'm not sitting next to him at Thanksgiving. Get his own turkey. Two things we're allowed to have. See, the priests weren't allowed to eat the fat. You know why? A fat, it's a picture of the rich delicacies, of the best of things, if you will. And you see, in the Old Covenant, this fat, it's symbolic of the mercies of God, the tender mercies of God, the grace of God. And under the law, you aren't allowed to partake of the mercies and the grace and the loving kindness of God. You are only to partake of the law. So if you either, you know, it's an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth kind of a thing, right? If you don't obey God, what happens to you? Most of us remember from Sunday school, you're going to hell. Right? No, that's what I learned in Sunday school. You see, this was the old covenant and the old thinking and the old teachings, you know, that if you didn't do what God, and I didn't even get a lot of support on that, I'm very surprised. You know, if you didn't do what God wanted you to do, he was angry with you. Some of you still believe that God's angry with you, you see, because you haven't yet come to the feast and God said, no, eat of the fat, man, eat of the rich delicacies, eat of the loving kindness and the mercies of God. You see, some of us weren't allowed to eat of the fat. We were told you can't eat of the fat. In the old covenant, you can't eat of the fat. And the old thinking, you're not allowed to eat of the fat. You can't partake of mercies and goodness and kindness. You have to partake of the ramifications of the law, because if you break the law, you're supposed to die, right? There you go, the ministry of death all over again. Mm-hmm. That's what we were delivered from. Okay. So you know, two things that we eat of, and I say to you first, you see, God says, first of all, what I'm allowed to eat at this Thanksgiving dinner is the abundant mercies of God. That's what I'm allowed to partake of. And before I pass that bowl of the abundant mercies, I'm going to put a large helping on my plate first. And the first thing I'm going to do, even as I come to church this morning and even as I prepare, I say, Lord, thank you for your mercies.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Because the first person that God wants to give mercy to is you. Amen. This banquet that he prepared, where you sometimes don't want to come to the banquet because you don't think you're worthy or you just can't get it right. You just still got these stupid things going on in your life. Anybody beside me? No? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. He says, I want you to come and eat of the fat. I know you think you're not allowed to eat the fat. He says, come here. Because I prepared a table for you. And in your old religion, in your old thinking, in the old covenant, he says, you aren't allowed to partake of these things, but I'm now opening up the table. And he says, first thing is, you're forgiven. He says, I love you, man. He says, eat of the mercies of God. You see, the veil is taken away. The condemnation of the law is taken away. I don't care what you did last night or this morning or a week ago. There is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. You are not condemned. You are forgiven. Anybody in the house?
Amen.
Come and partake of the table. Eat of the rich mercies of God. Because I'm going to tell you, as soon as I heard that from God, I took a big helping. I said, okay, Lord, thank you. That's what I said. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Me first. Me first. I'm going to take some of those mercies that I thought I wasn't allowed to take of. I'm going to be released from the condemnation of the law. Because if I want to live by the law, believe me, we're all condemned to death. Starting with the preacher, going way back to the back door. We're all condemned to death under this old administration, right? One more amen from your papa, you're done with me. Yeah. So you see, the feasting is of the fat things that are on the table. The fat things. And you know, the thing that I also like, and we'll close with this, is one of the things that God wants you to partake of in this banquet. He says, I want you to partake of the aged wine. And I remember reading this verse, and it was like 16 years ago, my mother and I were going over these passages, and it's like God is going to deliver us, and he's going to cause us to drink of the aged wine. And you say, what is the aged wine? And I'll tell you what the aged wine is. I think I heard Pastor Phil speaking about the marriage supper or the marriage feast of Cana, where God saved the best for last. And this is what the aged wine is. The best of you has not yet been experienced. You know, God is going to do something absolutely new in your life. But the interesting thing is the new thing that he's doing is absolutely old. It's the old thing that's been hidden deep inside of you, that God put inside of you before you were born. It's been reserved in the very darkness, in the very depths of you, in the wine cellar, if you will. You see, the best part of you is still down deep in the wine cellar, that God says, it's time to get the good wine out. And all of the things that you've experienced in life, as great as they are, God says, they're nothing compared to you. The old glory, you can't even compare the old glory to the new glory, my goodness. He says there's a life that I have not yet given you. It's something that's deep inside of you. It's not like you have to go to school and learn it all. He said, you already got it, man. He's just going to release it. He's going to release the aged wine from inside of you. Yeah, you see, and you know what's interesting? This is what I find interesting, and allow me to speak for a minute or two more. Is that all right? I shouldn't ask, but anyway. You see, when God removes the veil from your life, he removes some of the old things in your life. Some of us aren't happy about the old things that he removes in our lives, you know? And as you grow older, I'm going to tell you some of the things that he removes from your life as you grow older. Oh, excuse me, as we grow older. Some of the things that God removes from our lives as we grow older is certain aspects of our youth. Can I get a witness from anybody? Not this section here. Yeah, but you lose parts of your youth. You lose parts of your strength. And you see, I don't know, but I think lots of us don't like letting go of certain aspects. Right. Some of the good things you had in life, you know, like you don't want to let go of certain aspects of your youth or certain aspects of your strength. And even like Moses did, he put a veil over his face because he didn't want anybody to know that he was losing some of the good stuff in his life.
Amen.
And that's what we do. We hold on so tight because we don't want to lose some things in our lives. You know why we do that? Because God hasn't yet shown us that the glory that's about to be revealed in our lives, it's so much greater than what we ever had. Moses had no idea what was coming. He was holding on to that ministration of death. You know what you and I are doing when we hold on to certain things? We're holding on to death. And we don't even know it. God wants to release in us the aged wine, the things that are better than have ever been seen before. There's a part of you that has not yet experienced, the world has experienced, if you will. See, the glories that are still in front of us are the greatest glories that are yet to be on earth. Can I get an amen from somebody?
Amen.
And I know that in your lives there are certain things that come and there are certain things that go. But hear the word of the Lord today. Let him go. Anybody?
Amen.
Let him go. It's not because they weren't good. God says the old was good, but there's something so much greater coming.
Oh, yes.
Let him go. Let him go. That's hard sometimes, but he'll do it. Mm-hmm. And then he's going to release the good things. He's going to release the aged wine. And then the manager of the feast is going to say, wow, most people save the cheap stuff for last. But you know what God's going to do in your life and my life? He's saving the best for last.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. That's good. The best for last. And everybody's going to know it because all of the guests at the feast will say, wow.
We save the best for last. Amen? Amen. Why don't you all stand? Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask our praise and worship team to come forward. Every praise. We're going to praise the Lord a little bit on our Thanksgiving week, and then Pastor Phil will close us. God bless you, everybody.
Tell you is in our house, everyone has a chore for the Thanksgiving dinner, okay? My father, of course, will say the blessing, no surprise there. Keith and Nicole, they do take care of the turkey. My aunt will do the fried zucchini, cauliflower. I think Felicia has potatoes. You usually do cream, spinach, and all that. I open up the cranberries and the olives. Guess who's in charge of biscuits? I mean, seriously? And then he's going to point it out on us. Put him in on time and get him out on time. Amen. I hope everybody truly does enjoy this week, enjoy time with family and friends. And, you know, Mike, even as you were bringing forth that message and, you know, just the goodness of God and the goodness of God on us right now, church, you know, I was reminded of the priestly prayer when he went to Moses and he says, hey, grab Aaron and grab the family and grab them all. And he says, here's what I want you to tell them, that the Lord bless thee and keep thee, that the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you, that he will lift up his countenance and he will bring you peace. Amen. Listen, we are the royal priesthood, church. And his face, think about that, God shines upon you today. Today, God shines upon you. For what purpose? Because of his grace, it's his mercy. And then likewise, it's just to bring peace to those around us. So I pray that there truly is peace all around you this week, this Thanksgiving week, and that you just enjoy the goodness of God, and that you know that his face is shining upon you. Listen, it's shining upon you for a good reason, because he is happy with you. He loves you. He knows the goodness that he's created inside of you. Amen?
Amen.
Let's go before our Father. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that we do get to come and to worship you, Lord God. We thank you for the word, Lord God, that, Lord, the best, it's yet to come. It's yet to come, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, because you just love us so much, Lord. We pray, Lord, that your face will shine upon us all this week, Lord God. And we pray, Lord, that grace will be extended to those around us, that your peace will be extended to those around us, Lord. So we thank you, Lord, for the day, Lord, for your word, Lord. We hold on to it, Lord. It is a true treasure, Lord, that we will treasure for the rest of this week, Lord God. So we thank you for this day, Lord, for the family, and everybody said, Amen. Amen. Amen.